Romans chapter 12. We'll be turning a lot of places in the Bible tonight, so don't be lazy on this. And I mean that in a nice way. Don't not turn to the verses, because the verse is what's going to change your life tonight. I'm feeling like the Lord will change our life. I had a preacher years ago. He said, Brother Burton, he was 84 years old, he said, don't ever preach anything that did not get a hold of you first. And it was good advice, because I have preached stuff that had no bearing on me, and I just was preaching. And God never moved like He moves in stuff that touches me. I'm glad that I've not done that a lot, and really couldn't get real specific on it when I've done it. But I know that I have, but I do want to be a Bible preacher, stay true to it. The Lord can still bless it, because it's the preaching of His Word. But tonight I have something for you that I feel like the Lord wants us to do, and we're going to turn a lot of places. I really just have verses. I've got a few things written down, and so I would ask you to pray, because I would like the Lord to do a work with all of us tonight. And listen to me. This is something I'm going to preach on a lot, I believe. I'm just asking the Lord to lead me on it. But I want to exhaust it, and then the best I can by the preaching and studying. And then I'm hoping that everybody in our church will be sold out to the Lord. I believe God can do that. Statistically speaking, and looking at the shape that our churches are in across the world, people would say, no, it would never be that the whole church would be filled with the Holy Ghost. But it was in the New Testament, and I believe it was in the old days, and I believe possibly it could be right now in some churches. And I know that our church, listen to me, when I get up and say stuff like, let's make sure we follow the Lord in our offering and stuff, I'm just trying to lead you. I love you. You're the dearest people to me in the world, and I would never, and I don't want your money. I don't. And like I said, we had enough coming in that offering that would do what we think we need to do. But the Holy Spirit prodded me and said, Burton, you need to get up, and you're going to have to say some things. And we did, and I did it because I love you. And tonight I'm preaching this because I really believe God can touch us. And I know that He wants to. And so let's go ahead and begin reading Romans chapter number 12. Verse number 1 and 2, very familiar passage, very familiar verses, but they're very new to me as of late, and I know that they will help you tonight. And we're going to look at a lot of verses, so make sure you're ready to turn. Verse number 1 says, I beseech. And that word beseech means beg or implore or plead or pray. You therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Let's pray. Father, we love you. And Lord, I thank you for the Word of God tonight. I thank you for what it does. I thank you for the living book. I thank you, Lord, that verses that I've known and memorized for years can suddenly come to life through the Holy Spirit's prodding and leading. And I thank you for that, Lord. I pray, God, tonight you would speak to our hearts in a major way. I pray that you would bind Satan and his demons from upon this place. I pray that you would help to put out any negative thought from any person in our church tonight of something that may have been said or insinuated towards them by the devil's leading. And I pray that you would help us to be fresh and new. I pray that you'd forgive us of any sin in our life tonight, God, that we might be able to get a fresh drink from the Holy Ghost tonight and get a fresh new walk and a fresh new life in the Holy Spirit. Father, I pray that you do a mighty work here tonight. It will take you and you alone, hide me behind the cross. May I not say one thing that needs to be said that doesn't need to be said. May I not think one impure thought. May I not have one bad feeling. May it all be you. Fill me with your Spirit. Touch me, God, that I might be able to unload what you have. Set us on fire that folks would see us burn. And God, may we be moved and directed and not only shook or stirred, but Lord, may we be changed tonight by the Holy Spirit of God. Please touch us. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing.
Thank an emblem paid formality. It's a symbol that's been used so frequently. Many blaspheme and despise, though it's ancient, it abides. A shrine to death, this is for life to me. There was a cross made for the Son of God at Calvary. Two pieces of rough timber on a hill. Through his hands and through his feet, he took the nails for you and me. Angels watch as he died for the lost. Though he could have walked away, he chose the cross. You see why this soul emblem is so dear to me. It stood for suffering, yet it brought us peace. It bridged a gap for men, offered cleansing for our sins. An icon that reminds us that we're free. There was a cross made for the Son of God at Calvary. Two pieces of rough timber.
I want to talk to you about Romans chapter number 12, verse number 1 and 2. I want to come back to it in just a minute. I'm not really titled this message. I put being filled number 1. I feel like we'll preach on this for a while. I don't know what we'll preach. I'm not just built like that, but I know the Lord would like us to preach on this. And let me say this. When God saved you, God had a great plan for your life. And it was a plan that would be filled with His power, with His energy. We talked about today in Colossians chapter number 1. With His hand upon you, He had a perfect plan. And I want to say that most Christians in my life that I have known are not in that plan. And what I mean by that, I'm not judging them. I'm just speaking from conversations that I have with people, and I'm talking about me a lot. And speaking of conversations that I've had with people that would lead me to believe that they did not have what I'm about to talk to you about tonight and hope that we will have. Now, I do know people that I believe that they could be there. I believe that. And God had a plan when He saved us. And he wanted to give us life, which He did eternally, but He wanted to give us life more abundantly also.
Right.
And there is saved people, and then there are people that are saved, that are filled with the Holy Ghost of God, that are living in the fullness of Christ, that are living on the mountaintop of Christianity with all of God that they can get, and you're really wanting nothing but Him. And really living in and basking in the presence of God completely and fully, to where there would be nothing that could enter into them that would change them or take them off the road of the path for very long. And Paul writes a lot of stuff in our Bible through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. You see, most people get saved, and then they have a void in their life that they just cannot seem to fill. They begin to read their Bibles. They begin to pray. And when you first get it, it's unbelievable. I mean, you're really thinking, man, this is awesome. I'm reading, I'm praying, and I go soul winning sometimes, and I'm tithing, and it's great. But deep down in the recesses of your heart, you realize that there is a void and something is missing and you just can't get there. You get there, but it's very short time. You get in the presence of God sometimes in the morning, and then 5 minutes later you're out of it, you're in the world, and it's over. And you cannot figure out what has happened. And you try to get there, and you come to the altar, and you make decision after decision, and you say, God, I just want you. God, I need you. And God, help me. And then you say, man, I got to God tonight. You go back to your seat, and it lasts for a short time, and then next thing you know, you're right back to where you were. And God didn't intend for that to happen. I only wish that I would have gotten something from the Lord 8 years ago. Because I am the leader of the church, and a lot of you have been saved here, so it's not to your fault that I believe that this has happened. I believe it would be my fault. But too much is given, much is required, and I feel like I've just gotten some stuff, and I want to help you with it tonight. We ride high for a little bit, then we sputter and often can't seem to get over the hump. What is wrong with me, Lord? Why don't I like reading my Bible? How come I don't get from the Bible like Brother Burton gets from the Bible or says that he gets from the Bible? How come when I pray, I don't even think you're listening to me, Lord? And that's, I'm telling you, that's the way it is. Please do not go to sleep on me tonight. God wants us to live in the fullness of Christ. And we emphasize that tonight, just this morning in Colossians chapter 1, about being in Christ, letting Christ work in you, letting Christ be the leader of your life. He's come into our lives to abide forever if we're saved. We repented of our sin, we turned to the Lord and said, God, I want you to come in, I want you to save me. And God comes to save us. And He comes into our life. And that's a truth from the Bible. That is something we can count on. We can look to and say, Lord, you did that. And because of the Word of God, I am saved, and I am saved forever. But we don't get His fullness. We don't get that abundant life. We don't get that peace. We don't get that power. We don't get that love. What is missing in our life? Well, I want to tell you what it is. It's the absolute, unqualified surrender of our life to God to do His will instead of our will. God wants you to give every single thing of your life today to Him. And when you do that, and you're unqualified to give Him anything, you don't have anything to offer God. But it's an absolute surrender of every single thing in your life. I've said this many times. We think about our homes, we give them the front room, but we won't give them the back room. The back room would maybe be your finances. Or the back room would be your time. Or the back room would be your TV. Or the back room would be your kids. Or the back room would be you. And when God can only get into the front of the house, He doesn't own all the house. And it's just not the way God would have it to be. When we surrender our sins and believe, we receive the Holy Spirit. When we get saved, we surrender. God, I have to take my sin away. You died for my sin. I want you to come into my heart, and I want you to save me, and I'm trusting you and you only. Then we receive the Holy Spirit. But when we surrender our lives and believe, we're filled with the Holy Spirit. That's the thing that's missing in most Christians' lives is they've not surrendered their life to God. They've gotten saved, but they're still holding on to their life. They're still talking to their wives like they want to talk to them. They're still talking to their husbands like they want to talk to them. They're still treating their kids like they want to treat their kids. They're still treating people in public like they want to treat people in public. And God is not in there controlling them to the point where He can get something done. See, God has to have total control to be filled with the Spirit of God. God has to have total control. The receiving of the Spirit of God is an answer to repentance and faith. We repent, we put our faith, and we get His Spirit. The fullness of the Spirit of God is the answer to surrender and faith. God, you can have it all. At conversion, the Spirit enters. At surrender, the Spirit that has already entered takes full possession of you. Full possession. Not part of the possession. You do understand if you got to have something, if God wants everything and you only give Him 95%, while that's a good grade, it is not full possession of what God bought already and paid for. And God cannot do what He wants to do with 95% of you. He can help you in your areas of your life, but He can take good care. Listen, folks, I wouldn't doubt that I wouldn't say that God hasn't taken good care of everybody in this room, because He has done some miracles for all of us.
Yeah, right.
And that's, for the most part, with part possession. But if He gets full possession, He can do something. I'm going over my prayer list now. I bought a prayer book from when Brother Mike said he wrote his prayer list down. I write it down every day. Everything I'm praying for, every day. And man, God is starting to answer those prayers. It's amazing how He's starting to do it. I'm thinking, that's unbelievable. This man right here, Becky's husband, raised his hand for salvation today. We're praying for him to get saved. Amen. Raise his hands. That's a good start right there.
Amen.
I've been praying for certain folks in here to get jobs and get their lives answered and things for happening. God's starting to answer some stuff, and I believe He can do it. But before I bust out that book, I've got to make sure that I'm back in a surrender point. Guys, I can get so much of God in the morning and go through the whole day, and by the end of the day, I am wore out spiritually, and I'm thinking, I just need the Lord. But when I go through the whole day talking to Him, Lord, am I still with You? God, Lord, any of that. I get in my car, and just, Lord, if there's anything I've done, please help me. Please help me, Lord. I want to be with You. I want everything and anything. Anything You want, God, You can have it. Anything You want, You can have it. That's called surrender. The supreme human condition of the fullness of the Spirit is a life wholly surrendered to God to do His will. That's what God wants. Is you completely surrender to do His will. John McCarthy, a man of God, said this: how to get faith strengthened is not by striving after faith, but resting in the faithful one. You see, listen to me. God saved you. He had a perfect plan. He said, I'll save them. I'm going to give them the fullness of the Spirit. And then I'm just going to be totally in control of them, because they're going to be subservient to me, surrender to me, and I'll take full possession. And then I will just do miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. And I will anoint them for the service of God. And what I mean by that, Paul Bunyan sat in jail and the Spirit of God was upon him. The Apostle Paul sat in jail and the Spirit of God was upon him. And he knew the fullness of God. John the Revelator was on an island and God was all over him. And we think about Ananias Judson, the missionary, where God was all over him. And Hudson Taylor and these others that went across the world.
States in Great Britain at the same time, and he wasn't even well spoken. They made fun of his English. And it was because he had the fullness of God. And with the fullness of God, he said, the world has yet to see someone totally sold out to God, what God could do with a person like that. And so tonight, I'm just telling you, it's really all about surrender. It's surrender in our life. Take your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter number 6. Now stay with me, and you plug in, and you beg God, and you cast out the wicked one out of your mind, and you pray some warfare prayers that God would touch you tonight and help you. And I tell you, I just said, Lord, you can just come in and shake the whole place. But whether he shakes you or not, he shook me, and I'm sticking with him. I'm not giving up on him. And I'm going to make sure I get to him. And I'm going to make sure everything of me is surrendered. And I want Brother Paul to have a new pastor and a new best friend. I want Brother J.R. to have a new pastor and a new friend. And I want every one of you to have somebody new. And I'm not playing with this anymore. I've got to have God completely, because I want to be anointed for service. And I want to shake this whole city of Philadelphia. And I want to see that thing fall down when the architect said, hey, I'll just do it all. That's an answer to prayer right there on that little prayer list. And I'll pray for $250,000, I promise you. I believe God will give me every nickel of that $250,000. And we just keep on praying and begging for his will in my life. I'm begging for those people to be saved at that CrossFit. I'm begging for Kyrie to be saved, and Ricky to be saved. And then different folks in our church to be saved, our family members to be saved. I'm just begging God to do something, and it's only going to be if it's according to his will, we're praying in his will, and we're walking with him in his will. Now, I promise you, if you'll just be honest with yourself, you just have to say, am I in your will, Lord? I'm talking to the Sunday night crowd that's here, but I'm just telling you, Romans 6:13, look what it says. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. Talking to the same people now that are yielding their instruments, their bodies to sin. Whether it be their minds, their hands, their feet, they're yielding to sin. Yielding to sin. This says, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead. Now, act like God did something and yield to God. And your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Yield means just, God, take it. Lord, I can't do nothing. Just take it. Lord, I can't do anything, but you just take my life and have it. It's all yours, Lord. I'm yielding to you. You take it. You do what you want. You tell me, and I will do it. And I'm just saying, are we there? Look at verse 16. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey? You know what that means? You're either serving God or you're serving yourself. You're serving God or you're serving sin, which would be yourself. What he's saying there is, you know whoever you're serving, that's who, and you're obeying them, and that's who you're yielded to. And you cannot be yielded to yourself and your sin and to God at the same time. And he said, whoever you're yielded to, that's who you're a servant to. And that's who you're obeying. And I'm going to get somewhere with this. I want you to understand, God doesn't want us to do that. Look at verse 17. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart. You know what that is? That's salvation. You were a servant of sin, but now you obeyed from the heart. You got saved. Obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you. Salvation by grace through faith. Being then made free from sin. Hey, folks, listen to me. We do not have to yield to sin.
Right,
we don't have to do that. God says we've been freed from it if we've been delivered, been saved. Ye became servants of righteousness. Verse 19. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. I'm telling you this because we're all men when women in this room, and our flesh will mislead us, because if we're just not sold out to God and filled with God, it leaves room for us to be filled in there, and us is no good. Amen. Us doesn't work. We have to be sold out to Him. For as ye have yielded your member servants to uncleanliness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. Holiness is not a suit. Holiness is being like God. Be ye holy because I am holy. Be separated unto me and unto me only. A lot of Baptist churches are separated under standards. All the women are dressing right and all the men are dressing right and they have all the music and all that, but God's nowhere in it. They're doing it as a form of legalism. They're doing it to impress people and to show people they're better than people. But we're to be sold out for that stuff unto God, unto holiness. And because He died for me, I want Him. I want my kids. And if it hadn't happened to me, Brother Paul, my kids would have never been able to say that Daddy was the holiest person they ever met. But I hope to God that one day, as if my daddy was sold out his whole life, because he got filled back in 2017 and his life was changed forever. And folks, I'm just telling you, I get up here saying this kind of stuff. Devil hates me, and he's going to do everything he can do. He's going to put nastiness in front of me. He's going to do everything he can. But I'm just no greater as heathen is in you than heathens in the world.
Amen.
You know what's pretty neat about Romans chapter 6? It comes after Romans chapter 5. So that is pretty neat, Brother Burton. Romans 5:1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God. He tells us you get saved, you get justified by faith, you have peace with God. Then in Romans chapter 6, he says, don't yield to your flesh. Don't do that. Let God's holiness be inside of you that you won't yield. That you won't be looking for something. That you won't give in to a fight with your wife. That you won't give into a fight with your kids. That you won't give in to missing your Bible reading. That you won't give in to getting on your knees before a holy God and having a real prayer life. You see, if you're not doing that tonight, it's because you're filled with yourself. We have two natures after salvation. Before salvation, we're just the old man. That's it. We're not regenerated. We don't have the holiness of God in us. Now listen to this. The Spirit of God strives with us alongside of us before we get saved. I can look back and see how He always took care of me. Yeah. But when we get saved, He comes to live inside of me. And the problem is, and it's not a problem for God, the problem for us is that now we have two natures. We have the Spirit of God inside of us, and we have the old man inside of us. There are two of us in there at this point in time of our life when we get saved. And the two of them are mad at each other. The Bible says in Galatians 5:17, for the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary one to another, so that you cannot do the things you would. Listen to me. So that you cannot do the things that you would, because you've got the flesh and you've got the Spirit, and they're both inside there. And you cannot do it. They're contrary. They're enemies with each other. You can't do anything. You got two people, the old man and the new man. We all understand that. Some of us want to do right. There's some good people in this room. We want God to bless us. We want to walk with God. But we just never knew how to really do it. Galatians 5:16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Walk in the Spirit. Filled Spirit. The Spirit. You cannot walk in the Spirit half and half. There's no way to walk in the Spirit when you're half flesh and you're half spirit. They're lustless against each other. They're contrary to each other. So you cannot walk with them. We have to yield ourselves to God and say, Lord, take my life. This is it. I'm done with this. And we got to do it. Now, this is just the beginning, folks, because it just doesn't stay what you do it. You have to work with God, and you have to constantly be cleansing yourself, and you have to constantly be asking God to help you. And the more you walk with God, and the more you get cleansed from God, and the more you get rid of that sin on a daily basis, through the day, and the more you get it, the more you become apt to be able to continue it. Ephesians 4:23. Let's turn there. Let's turn over real quick. A lot more paper needs to be shuffling. Come on now. Ephesians 4:23. Make sure you get to it, folks. Listen to me. Don't laze out on the Lord. You need this. Ephesians 4:23. Look what it says. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Renewed in the spirit of your mind. We're body, soul, and spirit. Our souls are the seat of our emotions. Our will, our emotions, and our... that'd be good enough. The will and our emotions. That's who we are, is our soul. What we want, our mind. Will, mind, and emotions. That's what our soul is. And God tells us to be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that ye put on the new man, which after God is created. Listen to me. Did God create who you're acting like today? I know He created all of us, but I'm saying the new man. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Put on the new man, which after God has created in righteousness and true holiness. True holiness. Not the holy roll of Pentecostal church that thinks if you have a skirt that drags the ground and a bun that rolled up and no makeup on that you're holy. That's not holy. Right. It's not holy. Inside holiness. Where God is just controlling you. God wants to control you. Romans chapter number 1, the Bible says, Paul says, let's turn there, Romans chapter number 1. This is how Paul describes himself. Romans chapter number 1, verse number 1. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. That word servant there means slave. When he said this in the original language, it wasn't just a cool little, I'm a servant. I'm a stinking slave to Jesus. Now, I'm not into slavery or anything, but slave had no rights, and they did whatever the master told them to do, and they did it quickly. And they were made to do it. And so today, Paul says, I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. Why did he become a servant? Because he yielded to the Holy Spirit of God. How did he do that? Because he decided he didn't want the old man winning over the new man, and he was going to be totally sold out to God. It is possible in 2017 to be totally dependent, sold out upon God. God wants that. And God demands that. And listen, I'm telling you, the greatest thing ever happened to me was having that revival. And having Mike preach on prayer. Now I want to get to a message. Romans chapter number 12, verse number 1. Let's look at it. Tonight, you just have to ask yourself, do I want, this is simple, folks. Do I want all of God, or am I going to continue with all of me? And I don't even know how the odds would work. I hope that everybody gets God tonight and puts themselves down. And it changes their life, and they never go back to being the same. But chances are everybody won't. And you'll remain as a bickerer, a complainer, a person that loses all the time, a person that can never get any peace, a person that begs God for the same stuff all the time at this altar, a person that can never get the victory, a person with a void in their life. But you be saved. Because salvation is easy. Repent and believe.
But that's not what God wants. That's not where he stopped. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, because God has been so merciful to us, because God's been so good to us, and listen to me, because it would be a great life just to be controlled by him completely. I know that 100%. I know it. It's great just to be controlled by God. I think Don Green is controlled by God, 90-something years old, walks with God, prays 4 or 5 hours a day. I think Tom Williams would lock himself in between his staircase where he wouldn't fall down and pray 4 or 5 times a day. Tom Williams would go outside in a snowstorm and pray that the clouds be driven back. And before people I know, the clouds would open up. But what is that? He's anointed for the service of God, and God did things with those type of people. They were sold out, filled up. Most of us tonight, if I said, pray for me, you know good and well that God's not going to listen to you. That you wouldn't be able to get anything done for me. I shouldn't have said most of you, but some of you, it's definite, I'm sure. But it doesn't have to be like that, because we can be filled up with God and have all of him tonight. He says, I beg you, beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies. Now, I said this years ago on Christmas that the word present there, word present, it can be read either way. We give ourselves to God as a present. I was reading in a book, and that's exactly what present and present, they're the same word. I never knew that. They're the same exact meaning. To give away. And God says, if you'll present yourselves, give yourself away. Give your body away as a living sacrifice. I'm alive and I want to give myself totally to God. I don't need to be dead or to give myself like an animal would be killed in the Old Testament to their neck sliced and left at the altar. But I beseech you therefore, brother, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. It means you give up. And that's it, I'm done. You can have all of me. Every bit of me. And folks, listen to me. I'm praying every single day. God, don't let me have one impure thought, one impure word, one impure... And Lord, the reason I want to ask you that, God, is because I'm giving myself to you, and I want you just to control me completely. Last Sunday, I crashed my car 2 times. You know what happened? It fazed me a bit. I thought, oh, well, whatever. Let's get to church and preach. So what would have happened to you a month ago? Oh, I'd been a little upset. I'm just telling you, what affects you? Because great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. And love the law, which would be God's word, God's spirit, and who God is, and nothing will offend. And so God says, present your bodies, or present your bodies, a living sacrifice. Give yourself to me completely. That word present means to stand beside. What does it mean that? But what do you mean? You're here. Step out of yourself and say, God, you can have all of me now. To stand beside. That word present. God, I'm going to move out of myself. Literally, that's what it means. I move out of myself and you can take my life and have it. It means to recommend or substantiate. To be at hand, to aid, to assist, to bring before, to commend, to present, to prove, to provide, to show. That's what God wants. Just get outside yourself and give your life to me. Folks, I'm giving you the greatest thing you could ever do tonight. And really, I'm going to call Lansing, Michigan, Brother Paul, buy 100 of those books. And anybody that wants one, then I look you in the eye and feel like you're going to read it, because I ain't wasting my money or time with anybody. But it's an unbelievable deal about being the threefold secret of the Holy Spirit. You get on your Kindle for $2. It will change your life if you'll pray about it and ask God to help you. And Don Green told me to read it years ago. We're sent from the pulpit years ago, Brother Paul, in Michigan. Mississippi. A living sacrifice. Holy. What? So we give up ourselves and we become holy?
Yeah.
Acceptable unto God. Dominic, do you understand it? If we're at all in there, it's not acceptable to God. He bought the whole shebang. Holy, acceptable unto God. Not half-baked Christianity. Folks, God wants to anoint us for the service of His kingdom. God wants to anoint us to have the best families we could ever have. It wouldn't matter what your wife did, Daddy, if he was filled with the Holy Ghost. You could get through it and get over it and you could lead your family. It wouldn't matter, moms, what the husband did if he was filled with the Holy Ghost of God. And it's just the only way it's going to work is if you give your life to God. Holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. It's just reasonable to say right now. I mean, folks, listen to me. I was a salesman for years. I sold a thing called a rainbow vacuum cleaner. And if I would have been a drug addict, I'd be rich right now. I could sell that to anybody. $2,000 for that vacuum cleaner. But if I went into your house with it, you were going to buy it. It wouldn't matter. You'd have to put it on credit. You'd get that vacuum cleaner. Because I just make you say, yeah, isn't that good? It's like, well, I'd sell a couch to somebody. Doesn't that feel pretty good? Oh, yeah, yeah. Make a person say, yeah, 20 times. And then they have to say, yeah, when you ask them for the sale. And so tonight, I'm giving you something that's very reasonable. And you'd be a fool to walk out of here without it. But I shouldn't say that because I just want to say, let me backtrack that. I just don't know how God's working on you. I know what He did to me. And I'm just not going to miss my time with Him. And be not conformed to this world. See, we choose with our flesh to be conformed to the world. We want to be just like the world. Just like Hollywood. Just like the people talk. Just like everybody else. Or we can choose to be conformed to God. Our choices are easy. And they're just direct. There's no way to make an excuse for it. We choose what we choose. And it says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed. We've said this before, that word transform is metamorphi in the Greek. It's the same word for metamorphosis. It's the same word for when a caterpillar makes a cocoon around him and he goes into that cocoon and comes out a butterfly. A whole different animal. But be ye transformed. How can I transform me, Jesse? I can't. But I can if I surrender as a holy sacrifice to God. That's how I'll be transformed. We can pray, God, touch me. God, help me. God, change me. God, do it. But until we do it ourselves, we cannot get it. We won't get it. It won't happen. It has to be you. It's the only time I tell you that it has to be all you, but you have to do this. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, I read a verse to you, Ephesians 4:23, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. The renewing of your mind. How do we renew our mind, Brother Burton? We say, Lord, take my mind. Fill my mind with you today, Lord. Everything be about you. Every single thing be about you, Lord. May I please let it be about you. May I give everything for you today. The other day, my wife was tired, not feeling well, and she had to drive the kids to school, and inside I thought, I should probably drive for her. And I let her leave, and I thought, when I got back in the house, I thought, man, I blew it, man. Lord, I'm sorry, that was not you. A man would have jumped in that car for her and helped her, and she left her home. She came home, I said, honey, I should have drove for you. She goes, I was hoping you would, Lord, why would I think like that, Lord? Lord, so Bert, we'll just let's just get it right the next time. Serve her and help her. and do all you can do for everybody. And that hurt me to do that. I thought, man, I can't believe I sinned like that. Miss Kim will have no recollection of this conversation, but Noah was standing outside here yesterday, Kim. And me and Brother Paul were talking about Noah. And Kim says, Noah, they're out here looking for you. And I said, Kim, I'm not looking for Noah. And I walked down to my house and said, I wasn't nasty to her. She probably didn't think I was being nasty to her. But my heart was grieved. And I sat there and had to tell her I wasn't looking for her, like, you know, because it was none of her business what me and Paul were talking about. And I thought, man, I wouldn't have said that to her. I thought, Lord, I'm going to apologize to her right now. And God said, well, she probably doesn't realize that you did that to her. But that grieved my spirit. Man, I've been so long in my life, in my Christian life, where some things just don't grieve me. And I want to be grieved. I don't want to grieve the Holy Spirit of God, because I want to have the fullness of Him. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Step out of it. Give it to me, and be holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. But be not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let your mind be in me. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Philippians chapter 2. Take Jesus' mind. Folks, I promise you, if you get a hold of this, everything you read, it will all be about the Lord now. Everything has to be about His will and about who He is. 100%. And that's when we get anointed for the service of God. That's when we become the best daddy, the best kid, the best student. We become top notch. And because God is doing it, that's when our businesses will thrive the most. And I'm not talking about financially. I'm preaching that to you. I'm preaching that nothing will affect you because it's God. God has to do it. Then it says that you may prove. Look that word prove up. Pretty unbelievable word. To test. To allow. To examine. Or to try. That you may try. What is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God? You see, the perfect will of God and acceptable to God, I mean, those are two different things. Acceptable sounds like, well, it's just acceptable. But it's the perfect will of God. And listen, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And it ain't having your minds renewed. It just had out with the old, in with the new. Man, I've got to be different. I cannot afford to come down to this church and be me anymore. I've got to be God's man. And that's for every man in this room. I cannot come down here. I cannot wake up and not be God's lady. But what do? Get out of bed and get with God. And keep him all day long. We've said that for years. Shoulder the phone. Man, it all meant a lot to me before I preached. It's a good preacher. Shoulder the phone all day long. Yeah, we can do this. And I never understood what it really means. And that's what God wants. And that's how you get the fullness of Christ. That's how you get the where he is the one that works in you. But you prove what is that good and acceptable. What is acceptable to God is important to me. I want to be acceptable in His sight. I want to give Him everything so that nothing would be out of line. I can't afford to not be the best husband a person could ever have. I cannot afford to not be the best dad. And those folks right there will love me whether I'm good at it or not. But it's not acceptable to God. I have to be filled up with God. I have to limit sacrifice. Lord, I'm going to present my body. I'm stepping out of my body. You can have it. Fill it and do what you can do with it. And help me to follow in your footsteps. See, our mistake is this. People get saved and we tell them, study the word. Be diligent in prayer. Do good works. Give their substance to the Lord. Be faithful. ourselves with activities. And we're omitting the one supreme condition which God reveals in the Bible, and we fail to lift the single floodgate that God would come through and change everything. And we get His fullness. Colossians 3:3, Brother Jenkins said this to us. It means so much to me now. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. My life is supposed to be hid with Christ in God. When God goes to the filing cabinet of my life, or anybody, and they open it up, they find Burton Gates. You know what they'll open up? They look in there and see Jesus in there. And Jesus says, He's not here. And I'm really just underneath them. And Jesus said, You still don't hide you. He's not here. It's me. Hey, our life is hidden in Christ. And I'm just telling you, I've got to have Him. And it's the greatest life a person could ever live. And I've talked about that for years, and I didn't even know what it meant. And that's not that. I'm just telling you, I got saved. Went to Bible college two years later, a year and a half later, met her, started pastoring the church 4 years after I got saved. Just decided I was going to follow the Lord. And I've been faithful to the Lord and work and follow Him and trust in Him in a lot of areas of my life. But I've not ever given Him everything like I have recently. And I'm just telling you, I believe this with all my heart. Everything rises and falls on leadership. So I believe if you will pray for me, because I'm really, he said that the other day, pray for your preacher. And I thought, I hope they pray for me. Because I don't want to let you down, but I really don't want to let him down anymore. Amen. I don't want to walk out of my house and wonder. And I don't want to be on my prayer knees by praying and not be able to get a hold of God. I don't want people to say, pray for me, Pastor, and I never do. I will. I pray for you all the time, and I'm not. But if I just relinquish Burton Gates and give myself to God and a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is my reasonable service, holy and acceptable unto God. Man, we do that and everything changes. And I'm going to talk, the next time I preach, I may have to preach Thursday. I don't really know. May not be time to let anybody preach. Man, I just may need to keep preaching. But very quickly, God says we can abide in. He says, I am the vine and you are the branches. If you abide in me and I in you, you bring forth much fruit. Fruit of the Spirit. Not souls, but fruit of the Spirit and souls. I pray today, God, you've got to let somebody get saved. Someone's got to raise their hand in here, Lord. And the one I've been praying for raised his hand. He come forward. And I told him, I said, hey, man, you want to get together sometime? He goes, yeah, I want to have you in my house to eat. And I believe he's just ready to get saved. And I told his wife, I'm going to get there before that. We ain't got to come over and eat nothing. Hey, I want to see the miracles of God in my life. And listen, I'm not saying that I want to be filled with the Spirit so I can be a great preacher. Because this is not an outline. This is just verses with a few things written underneath it. And I don't care who's watching. I ain't got to be the polished preacher. I'd rather get up here and preach a bunch of junk filled with the Holy Spirit of God to see lives change. Amen. Than have a literal outline and bounce around and act like like something's happening to me and nothing's happening.
Right, amen.
And God wants to do that. He's going to use us all to do that. He wants to use everybody, but He wants you. He died for you. You ought to surrender your life. I've preached 100 messages on surrender around this country. Then it all goes back to that message I preached a couple weeks ago about being a child for God. Man, you just come down and get converted as a child and turn your life over to God. Say, lead me, guide me, direct me. I'm it, I'm done, and I need you, and I don't want to ever go back.
Amen.
But until you make that decision, you will flounder. And you will go back and forth on decisions. And you will never have the power of God. But Paul, I've had more of a clear mind and a lot less of a criticize in mind. That comes natural to me, to criticize everybody because they don't do it like I do it. And I'm not saying it's not going to be done like I want it to be done around here, because it is going to be. But I've not had any problems in my mind, it seems. It's just telling you. But you got to give yourself over to the Lord, and then you'll have to do that every single day. And you don't have to have a feeling. You ain't going to feel anything. You're trusting that God saved you, and now you're saying, Lord, because the promises of your word, you said if I give myself over to you, and I'm surrendering every area of my life today, my mouth, my eyes, my ears, my what I see, my thoughts, my will, my emotions, everything has to be you, Lord, and please fill me. Please don't let me get up without you, God. Fill me and change my mind, and may I not have one dishonest thought or impure thought or any harsh words or anything come to my mind, because I want out and I want you in. And if you'll get in and drive, I'll get in the trunk and let you drive me around. And God, please do that. And man, just boom. Everything happens. I really believe that. I believe that's the key. Head bowed and eyes closed. God spoke to you. You ought to get to the Lord. Now, folks, I'm just telling you.